The Northern Colorado defense led the way in UNC's 23-14 win over Carson Newman in the Division II National Championship. Northern Colorado senior defensive tackle Jim Porter keyed the defense's big day. Porter played the game of his life, recording 7 tackles, 2 for loss, 2 sacks, a forced fumble, and a fumble recovery.
Is it your best game?
Oh, by far. Yeah.
Because of the numbers? Because of what?
The numbers, yeah. And the win, you know. 2 sacks, that's more than I've had all season. I think I ended the season with a sack and a half or something like that. So, I don't know. I hit the right gaps today and got through there.
Did the defense at all talk about before the game, Jim, hey, let's go get some turnovers. Let's go make some plays like that. Or was it just business as usual and it happened to fall that way today?
Well, no. You know, Coach Glenn, he always... You know, before every game, he reminds everyone to handle the ball with your life. And if you're on defense, you know, get it back for us. So it's always something you look for on defense, is to get a strip or, you know, interception. I think we had 3 today. And, you know, that's the turnovers can turn around a game. And, you know, so that's what we're going for.
Jim, is it the fulfillment of all of your dreams as a football player?
Most definitely. I sat home last year and I watched this on ESPN too, and you know, this is all we thought about the whole season. So to finally get here and, you know, to go out like this, being a senior, I couldn't imagine it, dreamed it, you know, thought of it any better.
Offensive lineman Derek Frazier.
I just got to start off with just giving all the glory to God, because, I mean, to overcome so much adversity and everything, I mean, it's all his doing. I mean, he pulled this team together, and last night we all had a group prayer before we broke, and I mean, it's just awesome. And I mean, I just got to say, you know, I got to first give thanks to Lord Jesus Christ, because he's the one that got us here.
Derek, I'm curious, does it feel as you thought it might?
Well, I don't know. I think I'm still in a little bit of awe right now, but I mean, I'm just perma-grin right now. I'm keep smiling, and I mean, it really hasn't really set in yet, but I mean, it's just a great feeling knowing that we came here and went up against a good Carson Newman football team, and we took them on and we beat them. And even though the offense kind of sputtered in the second half, it was just, I mean, play after play, just digging in the trenches and getting what we need to do and protecting the football.
Derek, the last 3 weeks in the playoffs, the Bears needed miracles of sorts, if you want to use that word, and I have throughout, because they have been miracles to me. Today, it just seemed like UNC just outplayed Carson Newman and made more plays, especially on defense.
Well, I mean, no doubt our defense is the toughest defense in the nation, and they went out and played to their full potential today, just taking on a great Carson Newman team again, you know. And offense, we went out there, and we got a couple of good turnovers by the defense, and we went down and scored 2 touchdowns in the first half and then a field goal right before the halftime, and then got Mike Showers into some good field goal range in the second half. But I mean, it was just, we came out and we knew we could beat these guys. I mean, everyone talked about their speed and how quick they are, but we play Pitt State too, and they're a really quick team. And I mean, we compare these two teams a lot, and they're both two solid good defensive football teams. And we just went out there and we knew what we had to do, and we went out there and just got the job done.
Bears offensive lineman Derek Frazier is with us as Northern Colorado wins the national championship 23-14 over Carson Newman. You like the sound of that?
Yeah, I do. I like it a lot.
That's okay. You take that one.
Yeah, I will, most definitely.
Linebacker Brian Monroe.
Just a real satisfying feeling. This group of guys, we worked so hard. We started last spring, and you know, we really came together as a unit. It's incredible. It's just such a satisfying feeling to know you're number one.
And maybe the way that the Bears did it is as satisfying, with actually coming out on top. Everything that you guys went through, nothing came easy this year, did it?
No, we earned every little bit we got, we earned. That is just hands down, we earned everything.
Brian, in this game, the defense, as a group, you guys recovered 3 fumbles and intercepted 3 passes. Did you ever imagine that all of a sudden you guys would break out and get 6 turnovers in the championship game?
No, you can never think that. Obviously, that's what we hope for. Turnovers are a huge part of this, huge part of the game. And with 6 turnovers, it's hard to win no matter what.
How's the shoulder feel now?
It feels great, huh? What shoulder?
Exactly. After
it
this
feels
win.
Great. Yeah.
Defensive lineman Pat Kemble.
The Veer offense is something that you've seen before, something that the Bears were 2-0 against this year, yet still it was sort of the nemesis offense. Was it fitting that you had to stop the Veer today to win the national title?
It was. We've had so much, Jimmy Porter, we've had so much troubles with the Veer option in the past and trying to stop it. It is kind of fitting that, you know, we finally just came to play and took care of things.
2 tackles for you today, Pat, but you guys don't care about the stat sheets, do you?
No, I'm, Jimmy Porter, I'm a little jealous of Jimmy. He got a couple sacks, but he was killing them.
Pat, did you ever see not only a national championship season, but this type of season of battling through the adversity and the character building that this team would go through? Did you see that at all? Did you have any kind of hunch that it might be a different or strange season way back when you guys reported in August?
I didn't think we'd have a different or strange season. You know, I thought we would have a really good season. We were expecting big things. You know, this was our goal. What was first to go to the get the NCC. That one did come through. And the second one was to get here and win the national championship.
6 turnovers you have to sort of reach over and pat yourselves on the back as a defensive unit for that.
Definitely. I mean, when you get the ball that much and give it to our offense as much as they can and give them all the opportunities they had, that's our philosophy on defense, is give it to the offense. And, sometimes we're back down and would come up with big plays like that.
Defensive end Aaron Smith.
Where does this rank as far as defensive efforts this year? I mean, you hold a team that had been averaging about 29 points a game down to 14 points and in the biggest game of the year, and no points in the second half.
I think it ranked right up there with one of our best performances. I mean, counting all the fumbles and shutting them down in the second half, coming out even more intense, I'd put it up there right with the top performances we've had this year.
Tailback Billy Holmes.
It hasn't hit me. To me, it just feels like another big playoff win right now. Maybe it won't hit me until maybe we go to the airport and some people out there, or the ring comes through the mail or whatever. It just hasn't hit me right now. It just seems like we played a good team and then we just defeated them. And it seems like I got another week of practice, but it's all over, you know, reality.
And Billy, I know for you, it has been a season which saw you go from high expectations, much like the team, to the ankle injury and really not being Billy Holmes in the middle of the year to really showing your stuff over the last 4, 5, 6 weeks.
Right. I just, like you said, the ankle injury, coming in, I trained hard all summer with Brian Heil and stayed up here with the rest of the guys this summer and was dedicated to the program to try to bring home a national championship. And we started off on a roll, and for that stuff to happen was, discouraging, but, having faith in God and believing in Him that He'll bring you through the storm, and that sometimes you have to go through adversity in your life before you actually get to the light. And you know what? If I had to go through the ankle injuries, that's the reason for that, to get to a national championship, and it was worthwhile, that situation.
Billy, when did this team start talking about winning a national title?
Really this summer. We all knew, going to Pitt State, we experienced the playoffs, we liked it, we wanted more, we just didn't want to, just be in there. We wanted to win the whole thing. We felt like we had, some talent, and, God said that they were going to stay up here this summer and lift and work hard and do 7-on-7 and the whole nine. And I think the biggest thing, Mike, that brought this thing together was last night we had a players meeting, and a lot of emotion of different guys, the seniors leaving, and different guys spoke up, and, we prayed as a team. Players, we prayed together and closed the meeting, and then we went out there, and it just started as a few guys on the balcony talking and dancing the music, and it turned out into a full-blown pep rally with the band, coming through for us, and the cheerleaders. They did a great job, and we just thanked them for it. And I don't know, just the whole emotion. I mean, football is an emotional game, and whoever comes out there with the most emotion is going to win the game. And we just riding high off all the Greeley fans and all the University of Northern Colorado fans being there for us and traveling all this distance to support us.
Safety and punter, Dirk Johnson.
Who is to think Northern Colorado will win the national championship except us? So it's a good way to end the season for seniors and all the underclassmen. I mean, there's no bigger level than here, so we know how to get back.
Are you surprised, though? Is there a part of Dirk Johnson that still cannot believe that his team has won it all?
Yeah, I mean, I know we have great athletes, and a lot of it's we don't have a lot of showcase athletes, you know, that all these other teams have. They have all these other people that are so great, and we're just solid all the way across. Anywhere you look at it, I mean, everybody's great athletes. We're all the biggest thing is we're a team. We're together, and you know, and I think that's what brought us the championship.
Five punts for an average of 44 and a half yards, a couple at 55. Your first one was 55 yards, Dirk. And did that loosen you up a little bit in the punting department to get a good one off first go?
Yeah, it really did. I've seen myself as slack in the last, you know, 3 weeks or so. And it's been rough for me, you know, knowing that I can do better. But I've been hurting and it hasn't really been going that well, and I'm glad I came out today and you know, I guess more or less kind of reproved myself, I guess, that I can do it. And it just felt good today, and it was just one of those times to make plays, I guess.
How close were you at any point this year to calling it a season because of any of the various injuries?
I don't think I'd ever, you know, quit because I was hurting. It's a tough sport, and I guess you got to play with pain. And I got a thing up on my on the wall from Dick Butkus that says play with pain. And I mean, and it's just what you got to do. I mean, this isn't an easy sport, and there's a lot of contact, and you just got to deal with that and have a lot of heart, I guess.
Place kicker Mike Schauer.
We chatted yesterday at the workout, and you said you would welcome any opportunity to kick any field goal in any situation in this game, and that 42 yarder at the beginning seemed to set the tone for you.
Correct. Yeah, I was kind of felt a little bit left out those last two games. After Pitt State, it was such a builder for me, and then I didn't get to kick any of the next two games. And to come out at halftime, you know, I just relaxed and just swung through, and the ball went through, so that was real exciting.
Did you feel like you hit it well?
Yeah, all day I was hitting the ball real well, except for that last, the final field goal. I was a little bit rushed, but I was hitting the ball great. It was just coming off my foot real well, and closest maybe I've been to the zone all year, you know, like in practice, you know, when I hit the ball real well, I'd be walking off just watching it, and it was a great feeling. I was hitting the ball great today.
How does this work, Mike? Your first year as a player, second year in the program, you guys are national champions. How do you follow this up?
Ooh, three-peat maybe? I don't know. I ain't going to predict nothing, but it is big. You know, all us freshmen have been through it now, and we got a lot more years left to go, and it's been a great ride so far, and I think this experience is going to be great for the program, for the players, and, you know, we're going to have a lot of great years to come.
Tight end Andy Hazy.
How strange was it not to be involved in one of those nail biters down to the wire?
Actually, it felt kind of good. It felt real good. I mean, usually it was still nervous down to the wire because they could score onside kick. I'm on the hands team, you know. That could always happen. It's always exciting, but this is our biggest win in the playoffs, and it was just great.
Andy, congratulations. And I know for you, when you went down in the South Dakota State game, did you ever imagine that not only would you be back, the team would play long enough for you to get back, but play long enough to experience this?
Oh, I was praying, I was hoping, and I was dreaming, and they all came true today. They all came true.
Head coach Joe Glenn.
How about them Bears, Mike? Isn't that great?
How great is it?
Okay, where you want me to start? I just, right off the bat here, just say congratulations to all our fans that are still tuned in. You'd have been proud of them today. They came out and laid it on the line again and battled. We probably didn't play our greatest game in the playoffs, but they played hard. They played with a passion to win like they have in the playoffs this whole last month. Our defense was relentless, would not give in, and they went after that ball with tremendous amount of pride. They tore into them, and I really think, you know, the defensive turnovers were the big key in this game.
23-14, the Bears win it. Joe, what does it feel like to coach a national champion?
I just telling Pops and Kimball and those guys, when they're old and fat and bald, we'll be coming back to Greeley for 25, 30-year reunions of the national championship team in 96. This will last a long time. This one lasts forever. And people can talk about a trophy or a ring or those things, but what you got in your heart and what you got in your mind and your soul and all the good feelings we have for each other, our team and our fellow coaches and the parents and the families of all this, it'll be forever etched in my mind as the greatest year in football in my life.
Coach, you said that the greatest things have come to you when you least expected them. When did you begin to expect a national championship?
I'm not one of those guys expect it, but I thought after the Pittsburgh State game when Schauer knocked that field goal through at the buzzer, after that game when our kids walked off that field, you could feel they were elevated, and I'm going to use this word elevated probably a couple times, but they just all of a sudden, to coin a phrase by Jesse Tan and our motto, believe. They believe really more than ever to go into Pittsburgh and beat a good team there. I believe that was at that point they became a real contender for the national championship.
Coach, six turnovers today, as you mentioned, a championship effort by the defense. And the offense did enough. When you have a kicker like Mike Schauer, you send him out there, and he was a big difference today.
Right. Mike, those turnovers weren't flukes. I mean, when they got hit, I mean, they were jarred. That interception by Jesse Tan was a tremendous play. Brad Bunning's interception was a tremendous play. Jesse was kind of in coverage where he had his back to the quarterback, and when the ball went up, everybody on our sideline yelled ball, which you're supposed to, and at that point Jesse looked and just turned and made a great play. Bunning's interception was a great play. Those guys tearing into one time Allen got smacked on the option, and those things are going to happen when you hit somebody that hard. And then we were going after the football like you can't believe.
Head coach Joe Glenn of the UNC Bears is with us. UNC wins the national championship 23-14. Coach, do you have any idea when it will sink in?
It'll sink in the rest of my life, day to day to day. I probably doubt if a day will ever go by now. But what I won't think of these kids and these coaches on this team, something will remind me of something special about this team. And this is one you carry with you all the way to when you push up grass. Stay with you forever, Mike. So it'll continue to sink in. I'm still a little bit pinching myself and having done the conference after the game with the players. They're still kind of wondering, But the whole ride, the whole final month has just been a miracle month. I just, the coaching was tremendous. I credit the three coordinators, Kay Dalton, Mike Bresky, Marty English, coached them up today, boy. They had the kids ready. And our spiritual leader on our staff, Harvey Patton, great job. And all the assistant coaches, they just did a wonderful job. I don't think, Mike, we could have won this game without every last player, every last coach, every last fan that was here today. And I have to tell you, the pride of the Rockies, they were the spirit that we needed. They showed up at the motel last night for a pep rally. And I guess you'd have to picture a courtyard with a swimming pool in the middle and about three levels of, three levels of a walkway going around up above us. And our players were all out around the walkway, and the band walked in and rimmed the swimming pool. And when they hit the fight song and those things, I thought the water was going to come out of the pool. But it just was probably the most spirited moment of any team I've ever been a part of. And so I take my hat off to Dick Main and the administration at UNC for helping those band kids get down here and help us win the national championship, as well as our cheerleaders. They did a great job. And I would tell you, during all the TV timeouts at the game today, the pride of the Rockies was absolutely the top-notch entertainment, and this place wouldn't have been much without them.
Coach, also there have been so many guys on this team injured and some unable to make the trip down who were such big parts of this team. Yes, their backups came in and played very well, but it has been truly a team championship.
Yeah, Mike, I'd like to mention all the kids that are injured, and of course, you know, weren't here today. And of course, I know Tashi Williams, and he's probably listening. And not just them. A big part of this team has been Dan Libera, who's a guy that's going through some tough time right now. But I know Dan's listening, and Dan, we love you. You got a part of this championship, buddy, and feel so good about that.
Coach, it has been, as you said, a miraculous month, one that is now a forever part of the UNC football history.
Etched,
yes. You always wanted to use that, didn't
yes,
you?
Yes, yes.
But, Coach, I know I say this because many people have said it over the last month. It could not have happened to a nicer guy.
Well, thank you very much, and that humbles me a lot. But you know what, Mike? When you work with good people and you work with good kids and everybody pulling together, everybody going in the same direction, helping each other out and feeling so good about each other, why couldn't you be a good guy? I got a lot of guys helping us out, and it's just been a beautiful run.
Joe Glenn claims the national championship. The assistant coaches claim the national championship. The players claim the national championship. Not only the players who are here today, but also those who are injured this year who did not make the trip. Those who battled and gave to this program. Guys who come to mind like Tashi Williams. Guys like Jamie Heiner, who we mentioned earlier. Guys like Andy Hazy, who did end up playing later down the stretch in the playoffs, who was hurt. And we start to name Drew Mastin, an offensive lineman, who was banged up this year. The fullback position, Brian Applewhite, Kenyatta Algie, James Stova, all contributing at one point or another. Even guys like Harry Tillman and LaJon Vivens, whom the Bears had to struggle with and put their arms around and help through some tough times. Those guys part of this win as well. Guys like the nine Deuce corners. We mentioned most of them, but left out Max Keeler, who was hurt earlier on in the season with a ruptured spleen. And it has just been a remarkable run by a group of men that simply continued to battle and simply believed that they had the talent to take their place as national champions. And indeed, that belief has been fulfilled here in Alabama today. The Bears win a national championship. In many respects, it does not seem possible. Yet, on the other hand, it is more than possible. And in fact, a beautiful reality for UNC's fans, players, coaches, administration, and not only for that UNC community, but I think for the Front Range. I don't think it will be a stretch to say that Northern Colorado has sort of captured the hearts of people a little bit outside of just Greeley and outside of just Weld County. It has been an amazing run for this bunch of football players. The entire field now in shadows, the lights on, and the scoreboard remains the same. Northern Colorado 23, Carson Newman 14 in the Division II National Championship game. We also can at least tell you that tentative travel plans have Northern Colorado flying out of Muscle Shoals across the Tennessee River at 7:30 Central Time or 6:30 Mountain Time, which would put the Bears, we believe and we're guessing, back to DIA roughly 8:30 or 9, somewhere in that vicinity Mountain Time. And again, since it is a charter airplane, the team will not be proceeding through the terminal, again, to the best of our knowledge, if patterns hold from the past, and will be instead boarding the buses and heading right up to Greeley, and probably arriving at Butler Hancock, again, rough guess, 10 o'clock or 10:30 or so. Again, that might be a little bit early, it might be a little bit late, and if you're really worried about missing the team or wanting to be there right when the buses pull up, if you were there around 9:30 or 9:45, that would probably be plenty of time. So that is just at least the tentative plan. The team does have a dinner tonight in Florence at the convention center, the conference center, where the Division II Harlan Hill Award was given out to the player of the year in D2 college football last night. The team will eat there and proceed on to the airport and begin its journey back to Greeley and back to campus.
The Bears find a way. We'll be back in a moment on 1310 KFKA. After the team dinner in Florence, Northern Colorado began the trip back to Greeley. When the Bears arrived at Butler Hancock Hall at 11:30 p.m. on Saturday, December 14th, over 1,500 people were waiting to celebrate.
Arrived. They're starting to come in. We'll turn it over to the crowd. The Division II national champion, UNC Bears. The crowd pumping his fist in the air. The crowd on their feet. This is unbelievable. Here's UNC Athletic Director Jim Fallis about to address the crowd. Joe Klint saying, we're number one. Here's the crowd with him. Oh, this is special.
Ray, there's more electricity going on in this building than there is electricity being piped into this building. I tell you what, this building can run on its own.
Here's Jim Fallis.
At the beginning of the football season, Coach Rick Neuheisel promised the state of Colorado a national championship, and we delivered. Let me
Let me just say that it's that the community of Greeley, the University of Northern Colorado, has worked long and hard, and after 100 years of existence, the University of Northern Colorado deserves a national championship trophy. At this point in time, I think we need to have Coach Glenn and the captains do the formal presentation of this trophy to President Howard Skinner. President Skinner?
Joe Glenn,
go ahead and hand it to him.
Joe Glenn approaching the podium. He has the trophy in his hand. There's President Skinner. They exchange hugs.
Coach Glenn's got a few words he'd like to say, and then I know that the president has a few words he'd like to say as well. Coach Joe Glenn.
Well, the first thing I'd like to say, thank you so very much for coming out tonight, but congratulations to these young men sitting here. And our great coaching staff of the Bears, wherever they're at. I would tell you real quickly, there's so many things that go into a national championship, and I honest to gosh believe, and I've said this all along, that it's not just the team but or the coaches, but it's the spirit, the mystique, the family, the friends, the students, the people of Greeley, and all of you people make it. That's how you do it, right there. That's how you win a national championship, when everybody's pulling together, going the same direction, hanging together. I share a quick story with you. Last night at our motel, there was a courtyard about as big as this gym, and the players were all rimmed around, about ready for bed check, and the band marched in and did a pep rally, and I swear to God, the whole level of the field, the team, just rose about 100 feet in the air. When they took that field today, there was no way they were not going to win the national championship. The pride of the Rockies.
Now it'll be team captain.
I know on behalf of the players, we want to definitely thank all the fans and the students. You guys have been incredible. The city of Greeley has been just so helpful and so supportive of us through the years, especially with the new stadium being built. I have a little story. I know last night we had a players-only meeting, and this group of guys, we got a little emotional with each other. And the best part about it wasn't a bunch of me, I want to win this game, and, you know, I want to do great. It was, we gave thanks to each other. The older guys thank the younger guys, and the younger guys thank the older guys, and that kind of typifies this team, and what a great team it is. I can't say enough. Thank you very much.
Brian Monroe, Bear defensive captain. Here's Tom Beck, Bear quarterback. And his baby.
Well, here we are. Best team in the nation, the best fans in the nation. We now have something that we can say we are the best at, and none of this could have happened today without everyone here. You guys are the reason that we made it this far. We just want to thank everybody for turning out tonight, for supporting us throughout the year, and pushing us in this hunt for the national championship. And now we all can say we are number one. On behalf of the football team here tonight, we'd like to present this trophy. It's going to be hanging up for the rest of our lives. And in our trophy case to President Skinner tonight, to say thank you for all the support.
Trophy is handed over to President Skinner. He shakes both captains' hands, cradles it, holds it now above his head. President Skinner.
We said this morning to the graduating class that we wish this team well as it represented the university in a national championship game, first time in the history of the institution. And of course, it acquitted itself with valor and distinction and brought honor to this university.
President Skinner with the trophy over his head. Joe Glenn is getting the Pride of the Rockies ready to go. He's got his hands in the air, and they're going to get him started. Joe leading the band. Jesse Tan into the microphone. Crowd still on its feet. This is electrifying. Players milling around. President Skinner holding the trophy. Joe Glenn standing up front. We're going to try and get some of the players and maybe Joe to come over here and talk to us. What a special, special feeling and a very special event today. Tom Beck and his daughter has joined us, also Dirk Johnson. And Tom, congratulations, way to go.
Out here, and we are the national champions now.
How you feeling? First of all, you took a nasty hit. They said you had to go to the hospital for observation. You doing okay?
Yeah, I'm doing okay. I'm pretty sore, and my head's still ringing a little bit. But hey, when you're a national champion, I guess everything feels a little bit better.
You were there all year, the inspirational leader of this football team, and I can remember the quote that you made in the paper following the victory at Pittsburgh State, and I thought it was something that was quite defining of the season, where you said that we weren't here for this victory, we were here for four, and that really set the pace, didn't it?
Yeah, I really think it did. Our team, I mean, yesterday we had a big meeting as a team, And we said, you know, once again, our goal is to not just to be in the national championship, but to win it. And that's what we wanted to accomplish. And we went out and did it. And now we're the happiest group. And we couldn't have done it, of course, without all of our fans and without our family, friends, and support. and it's everyone. It's just a whole city victory right here, state victory.
How neat is it to be here tonight with what's going on?
Oh, this is the best. To have all these people here and showing their support and here backing us, this just shows, you know, what carried us through the playoffs. It was everybody. It wasn't just the guys that went out there and put the uniform on. It was everybody here, and we just love everyone for it.
Was there any singular juncture in this season where you thought that this wasn't an achievable thing, or can you identify or isolate anything like that?
I think the most would be after the St. Cloud State game. After we lost that, we were 5-3 in the conference. A lot of us really felt that, I think about everybody felt that it was about over, and you know, we were all but done. But we ended up then, from that point on, we just decided to start having fun and just see what would happen, and the good Lord watched over us, and he put us in this position. I think he really carried us through in the playoffs so we could win a national championship.
Dirk Johnson limps in here, and Dirk, the strong safety and the punter on the team, congratulations.
Thanks.
How does it feel?
It's starting to maybe sink in a little bit. It's hard to put a word on this feeling. What else can you say, but our team's number one, and nobody's better than us.
How special is this tonight? Did you expect all of this when you got here?
I think we expected some. We didn't really know what to expect, you know. Coming back, and I know our sport down there was really great, and this was just kind of like the icing on the cake to come back to our hometown and have all these fans here. This is great.
Makes it kind of worthwhile, doesn't it?
Yeah. You know if you're going to go into the postseason, you might as well just finish off with the championship, and if you're going to practice in the cold and do all that stuff, you might as well just come on with the big one.
We'll bring in Brandon Vogt. Brandon, come on in. We're live on KFKA. Brandon, of course, a local Weld County guy. How do you feel?
Oh, I feel, I mean, on top of the world. Hey, Weld County, we won the championship, huh?
It's amazing, isn't it?
Oh, jeez. I can't believe it. It still hasn't sunk in what we did, you know? I mean, I hope it does tomorrow when I'm laying at home or something, but it just hasn't sunk in how big this is.
You glad you made the decision to come up here and play some football?
No regrets, baby. No regrets.
Was there any point in this recent weeks of unfoldings that you thought that this was achievable?
Oh, yeah. To tell you the truth, after, you know, we won the three playoff games, it was so close, like in the last seconds, it was destiny. And we all could feel it. And you know, we're brotherhood, we're family, and everyone believed in each other. And we knew it was going to happen.
You know, this feeling won't end tonight, I'm sure. For you all, it's something that you all will carry through the rest of your lives, I'm sure, in large part.
Oh, definitely. We'll carry it through our hearts for the rest of our lives and on our fingers in those big old rings.
Tony Ramirez with us. Tony, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Your team went out and got it done today. How does it feel to be the national champions?
It's starting to hit me now. I mean, this is amazing. Didn't expect this kind of crowd, but it's awesome now.
Your team went out and you played the way you needed to play today. Sound, everybody came up big, and you guys got it done.
Yeah, it was a great effort by everybody. We kind of played a few errors in the first half, but we said, hey, if we go out and score a couple points, defense will shut them out, and that's what we did.
Did you ever expect this was going to happen?
After last week's game, I thought we could do it, but not at the beginning, no. I mean, it's just been amazing.
Does it feel like you thought it would feel?
It's starting to now. We were really tired on the way home, but now I think we can wake it up now.
What did you think when you walked in here?
You know what? I didn't have any idea there were all these people in here. We drove up in back of the building and unloaded our gear. I thought we might have a few people in the gym, and school was gone. I really didn't expect many people being here and walk into a packed house and... It says a lot for this great community.
Joe, your team went out there today and played like they knew what they were doing. And one of the things that I've been thinking about was how in a big game like this, every play is magnified. And it seemed like every time your team needed to make a play, the guy was in the right position and made the play. And I think that's a testament not only to your guys, but to your coaching. And you guys just came up huge today.
Right. I made so many plays all day long. On both offense and defense. I just a few names coming to mind. Of course, Billy, again, had all the yardage rushing, but I thought Brian Lusk might have had his best day as a Bear footballer. Tony Roberson, big plays. Jimmy Porter, 7 tackles, 2 sacks, a fumble recovery. Probably had his greatest day as a UNC Bear. Again, Pat Kimball, Aaron Smith, what can you say? Brian Monroe, Brad Bunning's big interception. Big time plays all over the place.
When did you start to think that, at what point in the game did you start to think that maybe you guys had to, I know I mentioned it at 8 minutes and my wife said, go knock on wood.
Hey, I would try to do it to you too. honest to gosh, I'm just kind of one of those people that anything can happen. And I felt real good when Tony intercepted that pass with 20 seconds or so left. But I thought maybe at halftime we were playing pretty hard, playing good with them, and I thought it had a little bit better than they did, a little bit more stuff on this given day anyway. A real fast team, so that scared me a little bit because, you know, they could explode at any second. But we seemed to have found the pace of the game defensively, and I was confident if we just didn't kill ourselves that we could win the game, and that's exactly what happened. We had so much pressure put on them, they finally broke and started turning the ball over, and it was enough to give us the win.
Joe, how critical was it early on in the game? You had some penalties that weren't extremely crippling at the time, but there were some penalties that you were victim of, and then they scored early on, and even though there's a lot of time to go, but a team that had lesser poise and lesser unity perhaps could have diminished a little bit.
Bob, you got it right. You said the word poise, and I really think all throughout this playoff tournament that we were in, we're behind so many times, and fighting and clawing and scratching, having to get off our back, just tremendous poise, and never a doubt of confidence in this team. They just kept believing. There's that word again. But what happened was in the first half, with a couple critical penalties, we probably could have maybe opened that thing up pretty good and maybe got away from them. But we had a holding call on a real critical first down, which I'm sure we did. I'm not saying there were bad calls. It just kept us from really shaking old Carson Newman loose.
137 teams, and UNC is the number one team in the nation, not because someone voted them, but because they earned it. Well, that's going to do it for tonight, and it has been a very special night, and it's been a special day and a special 3 or 4 week run for the University of Northern Colorado football team, as they have gone to the mountaintop and came down with the biggest trophy in all the land, the Division II National Championship.
There is more of The Bears Find a Way on 1310 KFKA. The 1996 Northern Colorado Bears won 12 games, a UNC record, lost only three, and claimed the first ever team national championship in the school's 104-year athletic history. The 96 Bears have taken their rightful place as the greatest team in the history of the university. Nearly every player on the roster contributed to the national championship at one time or another during the season. The coaches and players not only faced adversity, but triumphed over it. They not only exalted together while winning, they banded together when times got tough. They not only talked about winning, they sacrificed to do just that. Northern Colorado's 1996 Division II football national championship truly was a team accomplishment. Senior quarterback Tom Beck battled through rough stretches of play and turned in a fine season, hitting on 184 of 354 passes for 2,303 yards, 19 touchdowns, and only 8 interceptions over the course of a 15-game schedule. At season's end, Beck earned honorable mention All-North Central Conference. In his two-year career as UNC's starting quarterback, Beck won 21 games, lost 6, helped his team reach the playoffs both years, and was the starting signal caller of the national champions. While he may not have a trophy case full of personal honors at the end of his career, Beck possesses the only hardware that really matters, a national championship ring. Beck was the glue that held a battered offense together throughout the 1996 season. He was the consummate team player, and he was more talented than his statistics revealed. But Tom Beck's greatest asset to the 1996 Northern Colorado Bears was his ability to come through when everything was on the line. The more dire the situation, the hotter the fire burned in Captain Clutch.
Tom, what is it about the clutch situations that brings the best out in you? I know you've had help from your teammates, but as the quarterback, you're the trigger man, and you've been able to come through.
Well, I guess it just comes down to when the game's on the line, you know, I feel that, you know, I'm the best one out there and that we're going to win. And I love those situations. That's what I really strive. I mean, I think I relish in, and when I get the opportunity, it's a chance to really perform and come through for the team. And, you know, you got everyone counting on you to get the job done. And it's just been, you know, it's worked out positive for us. But there's nothing better than being in that situation and having a chance to win the game. And it really shows a chance to compete, and it shows what a competitor you are.
Have you ever at any point been afraid of the pressure situations?
No, no. I mean, I think you have to have some fear. I mean, of course, there's fear of, you know, winning and losing, but I think that's what helps drive you is, you know, of losing, of fear of losing the game. And so, I mean, it just kind of drives you and makes you know that, but I know that, you know, we're going to win the game. I mean, it's hard to believe that, you know, I mean, you're going to win it and you know it, but, you know, I know that I got the best guys with me, in the huddle with me. And it's not that you're doing it on your own. You got 11 guys out there, but then you got the whole team over there cheering you on. And so it's, So I never really say I was afraid of it. I really look forward to those opportunities. I mean, they take a lot out of you when you know, emotionally, but they're fun. They're a lot of fun to be in, and it's really nice when you come through and have a positive effort come forth.
Where does the inner strength come from for Tom Beck?
It has to come from God. I mean, God's the one that you know, gave me the talent and blessed me, and you know, and I couldn't do it without him. You know, he's the one that you know, made me who I am today.
One person keenly aware of everything Tom Beck brought to the playing field is his offensive coordinator, Kay Dalton.
I said all along, and people don't want to listen to me, that Tom Beck's the finest quarterback around. And he's always been that way. He was that way last year, and he's always been that way this year. Any quarterback at any level is going to have a game or two where they're not as quite as sharp as they are in other games. But he's a very confident guy, and he's trained well here. He, you know, this is his fifth year. He understands our offense, and he's a fierce competitor. He doesn't believe that he'll ever lose a ball game. I really can't say enough good things about Tom. I mean, he has never missed one of my meetings, and of course, you know me. I can chew him out pretty good at times. He takes that in good spirits. He's improved all the time, and. So what he's done, to answer your question, hasn't surprised me at all. To me, he can play in the National Football League. To me, he's the best quarterback in the North Central Conference. To me, he's the best quarterback I've seen anybody else have on these tapes we've seen. And, there's a couple of guys. We're just looking at a guy here a minute ago from Valdosta State, I guess, is an All-American. And watching him and Beck, I would take Beck every day over him. This guy has so many great character intangibles in terms of just everything he does. He's an intense competitor. He's a very unselfish person. And plus, he's a good athlete, and plus, he can throw the football well.
How much will the Bears miss him next season?
Oh, you're going to miss Tom Beck. You're going to miss those kind of guys all the time. We've got some young guys that are unproven. We'll just have to wait and see. But and you, as a coach, you just got to try to make all of them the best they can be. But I wouldn't want him to know it, but I'm going to miss him a lot.
Junior tailback Billy Holmes left his mark with UNC's regular season rushing record of 1,074 yards on 209 carries with 10 touchdowns. Including playoff games, Holmes rushed 315 times for 1,593 yards and 13 scores and averaged 5.1 yards per carry. In addition, he was the Bears' leading receiver with 34 catches, including one score. For his efforts, Holmes collected second-team All-America and first-team All-North Central Conference honors. Converted safety Mark Ciccarelli burst onto the scene as the starting fullback and rushed for 437 yards and scored 6 touchdowns. A 7th score came on a pass reception, one of 23 total catches for 215 yards. Tight end Andy Hazy finished 2nd on the team with 27 catches despite missing the final 3 regular season games. Hazy also accounted for 331 receiving yards and 3 touchdowns. His replacements, Brian Lusk and Ryan Richards, filled in more than admirably in the first extended playing time of their careers. Wide receivers Cliff Kasko, Keith Grable, and Omar Zuniga, a sophomore and 2 redshirt freshmen, respectively, with 1 career catch between them when the season began, grew into more than dependable wideouts, filling in for starters Steve Kensinger and LaJon Vivens. By the end of the season, a patchwork offensive line was held together by grit, character, heart, and a good deal of athletic tape, with starters Drew Mastin, Tashi Williams, and Colin Runge all missing at least 4 games each because of injuries. The Bears played the final third of the regular season without any healthy, experienced backup offensive linemen. Among the projected starters in the offensive line at the beginning of fall camp, only Tony Ramirez and Ed Bendokas were able to stay healthy all year. For the 2nd year in a row, Ramirez was named a first-team All-America tackle and was the most valuable lineman in the North Central Conference. When a lineman went down, one of the others reached a little bit deeper and found an extra dose of metal. Derek Frazier, John May, and Chad Ansell not only played, but they were crucial in UNC's drive to the national championship. To top it off, their determination enabled the Bears to save the redshirt years of all their true freshman offensive linemen. On defense, the Bears had a group of players who simply got the job done. No glitz, no hype, no superstars. Just a bunch of hard-nosed players who led the North Central Conference in rushing defense and total defense. During the year, the Bears surrendered a minuscule 107.5 yards per game on the ground and 293 yards of total offense per contest over the course of 15 games. Defensive end and tackle Pat Kemble shifted positions towards the end of the season to fill holes left by injuries. The senior finished 4th on the team in tackles with 89, 2nd with 6 sacks, tied for 2nd in tackles for loss, collecting 15, and earned 1st team All-North Central Conference and 2nd team All-Midwest Region honors. Kemble spearheaded a no-nonsense unit, which featured end Aaron Smith. He racked up big numbers and led UNC with 20 tackles for loss and 11.5 sacks, and also received recognition as an honorable mention All-Conference and 2nd team All-Region performer. Defensive tackle Jim Porter never grabbed the headlines, only the players on the opposing teams. Porter plugged the middle as well as anyone and managed to record 72 tackles, 12 tackles for loss, 5.5 sacks, 3 fumble recoveries, and a forced fumble. The linebacking core also reflected the tough nature of the defense. Brian Monroe moved from the outside to the middle and was more than a steadying force, finishing 5th on the team with 88 tackles. The Bears' defensive captain also registered 10 tackles for loss, 2 interceptions, 1 return 15 yards for a touchdown, and 4 other pass breakups. He also made the first team All-NCC defensive unit for the 2nd consecutive year. Sophomore Brian Scott, originally a walk-on to the UNC program, led the Bears with 124 tackles and also racked up a 0.5 sack, 2 pass breakups, 2 fumble recoveries, a forced fumble, and a blocked punt, which he took in for a score. Redshirt freshman Scott Zimmerman began the year at outside linebacker and later saw time at defensive end and middle linebacker. He wound up 2nd in tackles with 104 and 3rd with 14 tackles behind the line of scrimmage. Strong safety Dirk Johnson was the enforcer out of the secondary and winner of the 1996 Human Ice Bag Award for playing much of the season with a strained groin, sore elbow, nicked shoulder, and bothersome hand. Johnson made 99 tackles, the 3rd highest total on the team, broke up 8 passes, and was always there to deliver the big hit. The Nine Deuce quartet of fifth-year senior cornerbacks Tony Roberson, Delano Washington, Jesse Tan, and Max Keeler combined to intercept 10 passes and break up 28 others. Roberson led the way with 7 picks and was named to the All-Midwest Region second team. Washington was first team All-North Central Conference, first team All-Midwest Region, and first team All-America. Additional defensive contributors included Brad Bunting, Brandon Vogt, Matt Markley, Noland Easton, Brian Heil, Jeff Miller, Desi Lopez, Paul Robertson, Chad Neeson, Chris Wild, and John Curto. Jamie Heiner, Don Plute, and Donovan Brown were also major parts of the defense before they were hurt early in the season. Defensive coordinator Mike Bresky.
Did you see this type of unit developing in fall drill?
I thought we had the potential to have an outstanding defense going way back when the 2-a-days and even spring ball. We had a solid nucleus of seniors in the D-line, the linebacker position, and also in the secondary. We lost Jamie Heiner, Donnie Plute, who played a lot of football for the Bears. And we just had some youngsters step up, Jeff Miller, Scott Zimmerman, step up to the linebacker position and got better each game type situation. And I think they really gelled with the offense and the whole team with all the adversity we've gone through and turned it into a plus and started believing.
Is it the most talented defense you've had?
I don't think so. I think in terms of just athletic ability, I think we've had better talented defense, but that is not the only part of winning ball games. You've got to do the little things, the work ethic, the weight room, that type of thing, and I think all those little things gelled with this unit on both sides of the ball.
Did you see that kind of character early on in fall, that kind of heart and the intangibles, as you said?
I don't think so. If I could see that stuff, I wouldn't be in coaching. I'd be making some big-time bucks, but it just happens. And it's a chemistry, it's the personality of the team, which every year changes, even though most of the players are back, but that personality and chemistry changes each year. And I think it just developed as the season went on.
The special teams, often the forgotten part of a football team, received big lifts in every possible department. Redshirt freshman place kicker Mike Schauer stepped in and made 14 of 24 field goals, including one to force overtime against South Dakota, a season-long 47-yarder against North Dakota State, a 27-yard effort with 1 second left to beat Pittsburgh State in the first round of the playoffs, and 3 field goals in the national championship game against Carson Newman. His kicks of 42, 45, and 23 yards against the Eagles tied the record for the most field goals in the Division II National Championship. In 1996, Schauer also hit 45 of 50 extra points. Junior punter Dirk Johnson did it all on special teams, averaging 42.4 yards per kick, successfully executing 4 of 6 fake punt runs, and also throwing for a first down out of punt formation and returning 2 punts for touchdowns. Johnson earned first-team All-North Central Conference and third-team All-America accolades. Delano Washington, aside from his outstanding play on defense, was also a big part of the Bears' special teams. Washington blocked 4 kicks of the 9 that UNC recorded all year. Finally, return specialist Jesse Tan was first-team All-NCC and second-team All-America for averaging a school-best 34.2 yards per kickoff return. Tan brought 1 kickoff back 96 yards for a touchdown against Mesa State and a second one 90 yards to set up a score against Mankato State. In addition, Tan averaged 11.4 yards per punt return with a 51-yard touchdown against Augustana. Waiting to believe in a heart that's hopeful, a head that's full of dreams. But this becoming, it's harder than it seems. Feels like I'm looking for a reason. Roaming through the night to find my place in this world. My place in this world. Not a lot to lean on. I need your life to help me find my place in this world. My place. Thank you. Perhaps Jesse Tan's greatest contribution to the 1996 UNC Bears was his unshakable faith, his rock-solid belief that the Bears would somehow find a way. Throughout the season, the rest of the team picked up on Tan's theme of believe, and as the season progressed, the Bears' belief was the foundation which helped them overcome all the adversity.
When did Jesse Tan start believing?
During the South Dakota game, we were down like 2 touchdowns, and I was like, we can believe. If we believe and just vision it, then we can win this. And we start believing and rallying back, and unfortunately, we lost the game in overtime, which should never happen. If we wouldn't have believed, none of, we wouldn't even got that close. But all through the season, everybody starts seeing how if you believe and vision it, that there's nothing's not possible to accomplish.
Where does the belief come for you, Jesse?
My faith is in God. I mean, I was born, literally I was almost born in church on March 10th on Sunday. And my mom and my dad have always taught me how to pray and how to believe. And my father's a preacher, and my mom had God in her life ever since she was 11. She was born almost basically into the same situation I am. And they taught me just how to pray, how to talk to God, talk to him like you talk to anybody else, and just how to have faith. And in the Bible, they told me, it says, if you have faith the size of a grain of a mustard seed, then you can move mountains. So I figure, hey, if I can have just that much faith, all I want to do is win the national championship, and that's what I did.
Did you ever doubt?
There was time I doubt, but once I got the belief thing going, once I start doubting, someone else will say, hey, Jesse, you believe, or they'll do something that trigger, hey, Jesse, you're not believing. And I just thank people for doing that. I mean, once the belief thing got rolling, I mean, it was nothing that could stop us.
Do you think that the belief theme got rolling for you when you were encouraging your teammates, South Dakota, and all of a sudden on that wacky kickoff late in the game, Scott Zimmerman fumbles and it rolls right to Jesse Tan, who then almost takes it in? Did that convince your teammates in a sense?
Yeah, it did in a big way. So I tell them, I was like, hey, y'all, this game is not over. And I was like, yeah. I was like, hey, you just got to keep believing. And then they didn't kick the ball deep to me. And Zimmerman was running, and he fumbled, and it popped out right to me. And I got it, ran 68 yards down the left sideline, got tackled on the 7. And everybody was like, Jesse, just believe it. It's because of you. It's because of you. I said, nah, it's because of God. We just, all we gotta do is keep believing and envision it and claim it, and we can, all we have to do is receive it.
You mentioned faith. Can you comment on the faith of this football team?
I think the faith of our football team is, it's immeasurable. We're playing to win, not to playing not to lose. Because there is a difference, you know. If you're playing not to lose, you're playing safe. And when you're playing to win, you're attacking and you're being aggressive. And the faith of our team is like, whether there's a will, there's a way, we're going to get it done.
And now, how grateful are you and your teammates?
Wow. I don't even know how to explain it. And the full impact of a national championship hasn't really hit me. I mean, we're number one in the nation out of 137 Division II teams. We're number one in the nation, and then they still did pick us to win.
As much faith as the 1996 Northern Colorado Bears had in their ability to win the national championship, the result is still, for many, at least a touch unbelievable. He took the midnight train going.
Some dreams live on in time forever. Those dreams you want with all your core.
The 1996 Northern Colorado Bears reached for the top and made it there. The Bears were not the most talented team ever. Their record was not perfect. They did not have a collection of superstars. But head coach Joe Glenn knew it was still the best team with which he has ever been associated.
In all my years, I don't know if there, if there's been anything more miraculous. For all the adversity that the kids have faced this year, and players that have had surgery, and guys that we counted on to be big in our team this year, and did help us, you know, a certain. But when all went wrong about midseason, and we took on an abnormal amount of injuries, all of a sudden freshmen and people, and to name a couple, Brian Lusk, Chad Ansel, guys that we never counted on to step up and play like they have, really buoyed this team and gave this team the confidence and to pull together and put a run on at the end of the season, get us into the playoffs, and now we're getting some guys back and a little bit more steam in the engine, and Mike, it borders on miraculous from where I've been in coaching and from where I sat at St. Cloud. And I think I've told you this a couple times doing that interview after the game. You went easy on me, but we had lost a game on a cold, rainy, wet Minnesota day in St. Cloud, and it was a second loss in a row. We'd lost at Omaha and then lost at St. Cloud. We were injured, beat up. We had also lost another player that day, and it just looked like run the white flag up. But from that point on, and I hope this is a lesson to me and to anybody in life, never give up. And I guess that's the message. Because had we given up at that point, we could have just played it out for pride, and basically I thought that's about what we had left. But the right team beat the right team, and these kids came through for us offensively and defensively, and the rest is history.
Coach, as you think back to that postgame show at St. Cloud, I remember the exact question I asked you, which was, now with three losses, do you figure that you're out of the playoff picture? And your response, I remember very vividly as well, it was, oh, probably.
Yeah.
And yet, did you say, oh, probably, because somewhere deep down you were hoping that there was still a way?
Mike, I know. The very first year we got in the playoffs, I would say it's 1990.
Right.
We're about halfway through the season, and we needed to win out. And we were getting ready to play North Dakota, and they called me and did an interview, and I still have this article somewhere, but they said, what do you guys got left? And I said, hey, we're playing for the playoffs. And they said, what are you talking about? And I said, well, the way I see, if we win the rest of our games, we finish 7-3, I think, or 7-4, and that puts us tied for such and such in the conference, and we have beat them head-to-head. So it just about had us down at St. Cloud. But no, I mean, just the way things were going, we had been hurt that day again, some more injuries. We had turned the ball over a bunch, hadn't played particularly well on defense, as good as I'd hoped we'd play, and special teams just wasn't what it had been at one time, and it was gray and gloomy. And I flat started, after that interview, started walking about 2 miles in the rain back to our locker room. And I actually got over the river, and I looked down, and I never contemplated, but I did see how far it was down. I said, God, what a bummer. And I was wet, and then the coaches, somebody finally come back in the van and picked up the coaches, and they picked up me. And from that point on, my life has just come up nothing but roses, and, of course, the Bears football program. But it just, again, I go back to this to tell anybody, and I've told our players, whether it's in your marriage or in school, whether you're down in your grades or whether you're behind in payments or something, just start fighting. And just, we kind of have an old expression, don't look right or left, just keep sawing wood. And I know it's a kind of a stupid old expression, one that our players make fun of me because I say it so often. But when times are tough and you have a job that almost looks insurmountable, Michelle, my wife, always said, you know how to eat an elephant. It's one bite at a time, and you just start somewhere. And these players came back, and they started working hard, and they started with the new guys at new positions, and started pulling together. And I think the adversity, and I've told our team this, made us closer, made the feelings stronger toward each other, and it made this team what it is right now. I don't know, and I think Linda Delk asked me this. She said, do you think our football team would be as good right now if we wouldn't have had everybody injured and not had the adversity and not had that bond? And, you know, that's a hell of a question. I doubt if we would be. Take your hat off to these guys that, and I'm looking in tonight's paper about people like Ciccarelli and John May and Jeff Miller and guys like that, and Nolan Easton, Matt Markley, and Ryan Richards, Omar Zuniga. These guys are all first-year players here that just kind of stepped it up and got us. But again, that whole thing, it just don't give up. If you believe in something, keep hanging in there. Whether it's your job or whether it's a football team or whether it's a friendship, I'm not kidding you. These guys are a real inspiration to me as coaches as well, that just keep working, keep trying, do the things you know that you can do best. And it really worked out this for the best this time.
Beyond the wins and losses and the playoff victories and all of that, will that be the legacy of the 96 Bears?
That'll be what I remember about this football team, that the team that was wounded but kept coming. And I have that picture, incidentally, in the training room at UNC of the cowboy on the side of the mountain that had shot the bear, and the bear is wounded, but it's still chasing this cowboy and his horse, and his saddlebags are falling off. And that's kind of the way these kids were. They were wounded and beat up, and but there was no give up and no quit, and they just kept coming. And good things happened to them. We have persevered like nobody, no team I've ever had.
The Bears Find a Way will continue in a moment on 1310 KFKA. If I could reach.
This is one of the best defenses I've seen around here. I'm anxious to see them play against someone else and see what they can do. I'm also anxious to see what this offense can do, because, you know, a lot of the talk all fall's been the offense is struggling. We haven't had our full offense unit together. I know the guys we have around us, and I know once we get all on the same page and get clicking, that it's going to be explosive, and it could get ugly for some other teams around here. We got a lot of tough games at home. We have some tough games on the road. So we're looking forward to having a great year. And this year, we don't want to just go one and bow out of the playoffs. You know, we get some home games here on the playoffs and make a run at the national title.
Beck will throw. Muhammad stays in the backfield to block. Beck wants to go deep down the middle. He wants Grable. He got it at the 8. Gets away to the 5 and stretches in for the touchdown. First and 10, the Sioux at their own 4-yard line. Bears go traditional 4-3. Clancher to throw from the end zone. A lot of time over the middle. Intercepted by Monroe at the 15. Right side to the 10. Touchdown, Northern Colorado. This is a junkyard dog defense. These guys are tough. They're athletic. There are not many fat guys on there. And that's kind of what you look for in a defense. Big, lean and mean. Got the eye of the tiger, can run, smack, hit, and they're not real cute about it. They
They just want to be busy and tough, and that's the way we like it.
Is the bottom line, though, great athletes making plays for the Bears special teams?
I think so. I think I've seen other teams use some of the schemes that we might use without the same kind of athletes we have. And we discuss that a lot. Coach Glenn was a special teams coach here for a long time. And we sit down and go over game films. And now our special teams kids, when every Monday we have our meeting, they're picking stuff out.
Low snap again to the punter, and this time Kenzinger blocks it. He picks it up at the 11. He takes it in for the Bears touchdown. Two block punts, two scores for the punt team today. Can you believe that?
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Vivens right, Casco left, eye set for Tom Beck. Surveys a four-man front, straight 4-3-D. He wants to run option, pitches late to Holmes at the 40. Left side 35, has a lane to the 20, cuts back to the 15. He will score the touchdown.
The dogs say goodnight. And I
final 5 seconds, and that is going to do it. A smashing success to open up the 1996 season. It's all over at Nottingham Field. Northern Colorado makes it a blowout over Western State, 43-0.
Also on the faces.
Krull takes the snap, a little bit of a rush. He just gets it off over Washington. High floater, Kenzinger right hash at the 8-yard line. Starts left, gets a great block by Vogt. Stops at the 15, ducks inside to the 20, back to the sideline, 25, loose at the 30. He's at the 40, another block, he's loose at midfield. He's going to go the distance. Kenzinger at the 30, the 20, the 10. Touchdown, Northern Colorado on a 92-yard punt return.
Teal turns, gives, no, he'll play fake, roll to the left side to the 5, he will go to the corner, knocked out of bounds by Roberson at the 1. Can you believe that?
All 11 guys within 10 yards of the line. Play action, Feeney to roll to the right side in the open field, lofts it down the middle, it is intercepted by Bunning at the goal line. The 1, and the sophomore out of Platte Valley comes up with the defense's second big play of the afternoon. Beck puts the knee down, and the final 25 seconds will tick off, and the UNC Bears overcome adversity, tradition, and the vaunted Veer attack, and defeat the North Dakota State Bison.
What a wonderful world.
Fake counter, Beck rolls to the right, gets a block from Ben Dokas, has the sideline, first down across the 45 and out of bounds up near the 47-yard line. That was a pancake by Ed Ben Dokas.
Dogs say goodnight.
Clancher to throw, looks left, wants to go to the end zone. Now he's flushed out of there and dropped and flipped over by Pat Kimball at the 29. The Sioux playing for the fake now. Good snap. Johnson gets the leg into it, pooches a spiral high to the right side. It bounces at the 1 and rolls sideways and back to the 4-yard line. Dirk Johnson has sprinkled the magic dust on the feet this afternoon.
They really say
the final 15 seconds will tick off the clock at Roberts Stadium in Sioux City. Northern Colorado can begin to celebrate a grinded-out North Central Conference victory. It is now a final in Iowa. Bears 17, Chiefs 7, as Northern Colorado appears to be one more win away from a second consecutive berth in the NCAA Division II playoffs.
I think to myself, what a wonderful that's what you are.
Option to the left side. Fake pitch. Back to Keep. Has an alley 30. Left side 20. He cuts back at the 10. He gets away to the 5. He strolls in for the Northern Colorado touchdown. 2:19 to go in the third, and Tom Beck has scored on the ground for the third time this afternoon to the delight of the homecoming faithful at Nottingham.
Never before.
UNC with one last chance. 1:35 remaining, trailing Northwest Missouri State 26-21. The season in the balance for Northern Colorado. They'll go left to right. One timeout, first and 10, own 20-yard line. Tom Beck, the senior, trots back onto the field for what could be his final time, his final drive.
That's how you'll stay.
Tom will throw, drops back. Now he steps up at the 10, feels the heat, runs to the 20. He's got room straight ahead to the 30. Runs to the left, wants to get out of bounds. 35, down the sideline, tiptoes for extra yardage. Out of bounds at the 42. You've got the guy at the trigger that you want there, the veteran, experienced quarterback, senior Tom Beck. You mentioned it. Is this going to be his last drive when he came out to start this drive? And I don't think so. Beck to sprint out on first and 10. Pump fake. Looks back to the left. He wants Holmes down the sideline. Has it at the 20. He's down to the 10-yard line.
Since I was a little kid, I'd hate to lose to anything. I'd get so upset when my dad would beat me in anything that it just... I hate to lose this one. It is the worst feeling in the world to me, and so I'll do anything to win.
I wouldn't want him to know it, but I'm going to miss him a lot.
Whitney has a teed at the 35. He'll squib it down the middle. Takes a hop. Left side, it's Scott Zimmerman at the 25 to the 30. Zimmerman will be brought down at the 32-yard line. He pitches it to Tan. Left side, he's to the 40. Jesse loops to the 50, to the 40, the 30. He is going to go to the 10, and he's pulled down at the 7-yard line. Zimmerman on his way down pitched it or rolled it over to Jesse Tan, and the Bears are inside the 10 with 14 seconds to go. Can you believe that?
That someone so
Dirk Johnson, the punter, stands at his 20. Has to get to the 45 for a first. Here comes the rush, and he booms a high wobbler that chases Washington back. He lets it bounce at the 10. It's to the 5. It's trickling inside the 5. It's down at the 1 by Monroe. Can you believe that? A 64-yarder down at the 1.
Dreams God planted in the fertile soil of you. I can't believe the hope.
I think this group of guys, is, you just love them to death, and it's great. I mean, you know, it doesn't matter what happens. You know, guys are sick or hurt, and whoever's out there is asked to play steps up and rises their level of play and just shows the character and heart. And it's just fun to be around guys like that, because no matter what, it seems like we're always in a game. I mean, no matter what the score is, it seems like somehow someone's going to do something to make it where, we got a shot to win at the end of the game. And that's just fun to be around, see guys compete and just, you know, pouring their hearts out on the field.
It stems from all the way from the seniors down to the incoming freshmen. We all just get along so well, and we all want to win. We all want to see, you know, what kind of team we are.
When we give up big plays, nobody gets mad at each other or starts chipping, stuff like that. We hang together, and we know we're going to get it back eventually.
I have confidence and faith in anybody that's watching for me. I think that they're going to give it all they got. And those group of guys that had to step in, they have a lot of heart, and they go 100 miles an hour and 100% on every play. So, I mean, when you got people like that that's giving it all they got, they may not be as big as the other guys or as strong, but when they're giving it all they got, they get the job done. So, I definitely believe that they can do that.
We got down to Pitt State, and our coaches had watched a lot more film than the kids, and namely one Kay Dalton. And this was some psychology. He's a psychology major, you know that. But he has the offense in this room before the game, and I can't put all the adjectives in on this, but Kay said, "All right, you guys, it's your fault we're here." I never thought we'd be here. None of the coaches ever thought we'd be here, but you went and did it to yourself. You're the ones that got us into this jam. And I'm laughing, of course, Dobbs and Adams and Harvey Patton, all of us are knee slapping because we're kind of in the back and we can see Kay putting it on these kids. But he really, what he was doing was, again, telling them, all right, you've gotten us this far and we never thought you'd do this. But now you've really got us into a jam because we got to go play a real good team. And Danfley didn't respond to that as well.
Against Northwest Missouri, we was on the 10-yard line, and they were up, and they were about to score. There was a timeout, and I'm like thinking to myself, oh, man, if they score in this game. And Pat Kimball, out of nowhere, he just starts laughing. And he says, whoo, ain't this fun, y'all? And I'm like looking at him, are you crazy? They're about to score and put the game out of reach. And then that's when I start thinking, Jesse, he's believing. You got to believe. You got to keep believing. And then out of the blue, he said, we're going to get this ball back and pitch the ball to me. I'm going to run a touchdown. We're 80 yards away from our touchdown. And he says, pitch it to him. I say, this man is believing. You got to keep believing, too.
And a lot of people use that lightly, but it is the truth. We are just one big family out here. To live as friends. Thank you.
talked about humility, and they were a humble bunch. Yeah. They, every time we got on an airplane, it seemed like, and the trip was over, the stewardesses or the captains that came out of their way to say, what a nice bunch, and great manners, and the motel people, almost one after the other, just said, what a nice bunch of kids, and they really took good care of themselves, and so thankful for everything, and even in the championship game, we got lit up a couple times, I mean, and Jesse Tan was returning a punt or kickoff, I forget, and got just clobbered. He got up and gave the kid a high five and said, great hit, you know, it's just that type of fun, loving, and just spirited play that I think really made the personality of this team a championship team.
Here's Holmes up the middle, wide open, running, bangs off a Viking across the 35. He's across the 30, finally pulled down near the 20-yard line. And that will be the record breaker for Billy Holmes. A new single-season rushing record without a doubt, as he had wide open running up the middle. Fumbled snap, ball loose, and there's a pile up at the 37, and Northern Colorado has recovered. The defense puts an exclamation point on it, and appropriately so. It's senior Pat Kemble who emerges from the muck and mud and ice with the pigskin.
Tom Beck wants to throw. Good protection. Zips it left flat. He's got Hazy on the move. 15 to the 10 down the sideline. Hurdles over and scores the touchdown.
On a first and 10 play, Ciccarelli has room up the middle. To the 40. Cuts to the left to the 30. To the 20. He will go into the end zone. And the Bears lead it 13 to nothing on the 45-yard scamper by Ciccarelli.
Unbalanced line to the left side this time. Split backs. Feeney runs to the left side. He'll keep. He's dragged down by Chris Wild. Ball loose. Wild has it at the five. Touchdown, Northern Colorado. Morris and Scott split behind Feeney, who rolls to the right. Pump fake. Here comes the pressure. Zimmerman sacks him back at the 7-yard line. So stay with me, baby. A little bit of a high snap. Dirk is going to run left side to the 10. He's to the 20. Left sideline 30. Tripped up, but he stays on his feet to the 40. Across midfield. Can you believe that? From his own one, Dirk Johnson calls his own number, and the Bears get it across midfield on another successful fake punt. Absolutely incredible.
Back to throw, good protection, deep down the left side, Kenzinger reaches up, bobbling catch in the end zone for the touchdown over Duggar. Can you believe that? The Bears are within two with 3:25 to go on a miraculous catch by Kenzinger.
Low snap, it rolls, and this one's blocked by Brian Scott. Loose at the five, Scott has it, and he's in for the touchdown. This is the time
to remember. Fake counter, Beck to roll to the right. Gets a block from Ben Dokas. Gets the corner to the 15. Gets another block to the 10. Into the corner of the end zone. Touchdown, UNC. This is the time.
Two receivers. receivers left. Now Grable in motion to the right on first and 10 from the 15. Holmes sweeps left, cuts back to the 10, rolls over Husky to the 5, turns hard and stretches close. He is in for the touchdown.
Sometimes it's so easy to let a day slip on by.
Jaden throws, zips it over the middle, intercepted by the Bears' Tony Roberson. Playing free safety in the nickel package, he comes up with his fifth pick of the year. Beck will throw, straight drop back, he's at the 20, goes deep down the right sideline, wants Kenzinger, has a step, it's up for grabs, and Kenzinger comes down with it at the Mankato State 30 as he took it away from Washington. Incredible. UNC remains unbeaten in the hallowed halls of Camelot, Nottingham Field. Final 10 seconds. Drifting off the clock. The Bears celebrate homecoming 96 with a hard-fought win over Mankato State 44-27.
These guys are definitely the most beautiful team, and I say the word team with a lot of passion, that I've ever coached, and they are deserving of the national championship.
Adjust the tuning, try a new translation.
Northern Colorado is heading to the postseason for the second straight year thanks to a 41-7 blowout of Augustana.
Just because you don't see shooting stars doesn't mean it isn't perfect. Can't you see?
Play action. Segrist to roll. He'll set up over the middle. Pass intercepted by Monroe at the Bears 30. Left side to the 40. He chugs to the 45 and scoots out of bounds at the 48. And they'll get more yardage on the late hit.
It's the stuff that dreams are made of.
Daniels and Ciccarelli flip behind Beck, who wants to throw. Looking into the end zone. Left corner wants Grable. Has it for the touchdown.
Got a brand new shiny boy, and they're moving out.
We drew a parallel between the fight between Evander Holyfield and Mike Tyson, and we took the side of Evander and talked about, you know, how what a brave guy he was, and how we respected our opponents but we didn't fear him, and that we trained hard just like he had, that we were careful, be careful and smart, and we had a plan and no panic, and we needed some turnovers and capitalize on some big stuff, but we kind of rode that horse in here, and as I said earlier, now let's tiptoe out of town with a win.
Procedure on Northwest. Whoa.
Incredible.
That's big.
23-21 Northwest, 1:45 to go. This will bring third and goal back at the 6 after he scored the touchdown.
Oh, boy, that's big.
That's right now what's keeping the Bears alive. Center facing the four-man front. The senior back to pass. Deep drop. Left side in the corner. Out there it is. Caught by Zuniga. Touchdown, Northern Colorado with 1:25 to go.
Shoot the stars off in your own backyard. Don't look any further and you will see.
God's looking over us, and that's about all I can say about that, because keep putting us in these opportunities and keep letting us come out on top. I know we got a lot of guys that believe, a lot of guys that never say die, but this is the greatest feeling. Is right now, I think, I was just telling Omar, the only feeling that's going to beat this right now is next week about this time for a champion, national champion. But I can't explain how we keep winning these games late, how they keep coming out. Everyone keeps telling me, next week, we'll see what we win by couple more points in one and not late in the game. Save our heart a little bit. I don't know what it is about this team. You said it, I think, about a month ago, that they are just on a team of destiny. And I don't know how to respond to that, and I never have, but whatever that means, I mean, we must be getting close to whatever destiny is, huh?
Every kid that plays football when he's little has to dream about something like this.
I was thinking in bed last night how little kids, even if you're throwing a rubber ball off the steps or something like that, it's always 3-2, two outs, bottom of the ninth, we need a hit. In football, it's playing for the national championship. That's what you dream about from the time you're a little kid.
Second and 4 from the Eagles 36. A receiver to either side, and Beck drops back to pass. Goes deep down the middle. Wants Hazy. He's there at the 5. He's into the end zone. Northern Colorado touchdown.
I want it all.
Second and goal from the Eagle 1. Two tight ends. Keith Grable, the wingman, in motion to the left. Second back. Pitch to the right. Holmes has an alley. dives into the end zone for the UNC touchdown. Second and one from the UNC 14. Christopher and Ripito split wide to the left, Parks to the right. Westmoreland and Morton again, the Veerbacks. No tight ends on the line for Carson Newman. Allen hollering signals on the option. He'll keep to the left side, fake the pitch, dives, fumbled the ball, loose at the seven. Who's got it? Northern Colorado comes up with the football. Second and inches from the Bear 31. Allen will throw out of this formation and this down and distance in trouble, and he is dropped by Jim Porter at the 40-yard line. Showers 2 for 2 today, hit from 42 and 45. This will be a 23-yarder from the left hash mark. Tom Beck to hold, gets the snap, plays down, kick on the way, good. It's the hat trick for Mike Schauer in the national championship game. And with 11:20 to go, it's the Bears 23, the Eagles 14.
I just telling Pops and Kimball and those guys, when they're old and fat and bald, we'll be coming back to Greeley for 25 and 30 year reunions of the national championship team in 96. This will last a long time. This one lasts forever. And people can talk about a trophy or a ring or those things, but what you've got in your heart and what you've got in your mind and your soul and all the good feelings we have for each other, our team and our fellow coaches and the parents and the families of all this, it'll be forever etched in my mind as the greatest year in football in my life.
Seconds left, tied at 21. Mike Schauer to try a 27-yard field goal from the middle of the field out of Tom Beck's hold for the Bears' first ever postseason win against the winningest team in college football over the last decade. Beck checks with Schauer, the redshirt freshman. So much pressure riding on everything. Snap, place down, kick is on the way. It is good! And with 1 second to go, the Bears have come to Pittsburgh State and shown that they are indeed the king of the jungle.
And we'll 18 seconds remain. Bears down 26-21. First and goal from the Northwest 2. Baxter split, Holmes and Ciccarelli. Double receivers right. Tom Beck rolls to the right side. Will he pass? Will he run? Still running in the end zone. Touchdown, Zuniga! Bears lead with 12 seconds to go. Can you believe that?
A 31-yard attempt, national title hopes on the line, a trip to the title game riding on this kick. The left footer taps his toe twice into the mud. Forney looking down at the spot, reaching for the snap. Place down, kick is on the way, it is tipped, it is short, and Northern Colorado has come to the land where football is king and taken the Golden Eagles off their perch. 19-18, Northern Colorado will play for the Division II National Championship. My friend. Three straight dramatic finishes in the playoffs for the UNC Bears leave many wondering if this is not the year. Abrahamson touches the right knee onto the turf. The final 15 seconds tick off. The players filter out onto the field at Braley Municipal Stadium. Final 6 seconds to go. 4, 3, 2, 1.
The Northern Colorado Bears are the national champions of Division II college football. It is the stuff reserved for the dreams of youth. Today, the Northern Colorado players and coaches are boys once again with championship dreams now a wonderful reality.
I've paid my dues. Time after
heart and the immeasurable things, desire, determination, will to win, desire to win, don't want to lose, rank this team number one.
I've made a few. I've had my share and kicked in my best.
Michael Schauer, number one place kicker. Ryan Abrahams, the number four quarterback.
Brian Lust, number 82, tight end. Chad Ansel, number 78, offensive tackle.
Keith Crable, number 8, wide receiver.
Matt Markley, number 96, D-line.
Scott Zimmerman, number 48, linebacker.
Aaron Smith, number 91, defensive end.
Tony Ramirez, offensive tackle, number 75.
Edmund Dokas, offensive guard, number 69.
Derek Frazier, center, 73.
Colin Runge, 67, right guard.
J.D. Johnson, number 35, defensive back.
Andy Hazzie, number 87, tight end.
Jamie Heiner, number 80, LB.
Ryan Richards, number 88, tight end.
John May, number 74, offensive center.
Wow.
Max Keeler, cornerback, number 38.
Omar Zuniga, wide receiver, number 83.
Tony Ramirez, number 75, offensive line.
Jim Porter, number 50, defensive line.
Ron Regan, number 36, fullback.
Todd Weibel, number 20, free safety.
Brian Heil, 52, D-line.
Carl Robertson, 51, LB.
Desi Lopez, number 5, the end.
Chad Neeson, number 3, corner.
Court McGuffey, number 12, quarterback.
Jeff Miller, 45, LB.
Brad Bunning, number 11, free safety.
Wes Daniels, number 29, running back.
Cliff Castle, number 17, wide receiver.
Dean Grable, number 9, quarterback.
Billy Holmes, number 21, running back.
Brandon Vogt, number 27, free safety and national champion.
Brian Scott, number 46, linebacker.
Heath Kutra, number 95, linebacker.
Tex, Brian Lonergan, tight end, number 43.
Mark Ciccarelli, 44, fullback.
My name is Noel Easton, number 6, strong safety.
Delano Washington, number 37, cornerback.
Brian Monroe, number 41, linebacker.
Dirk Johnson, number 10, punter, strong safety.
Pat Kimball, number 97, defensive line.
Tony and Aeneas Roberson, number 18, nine deuce corner.
Tom Beck, number 7, quarterback.
John Curdo, linebacker, 59.
Jesse Terran, number 23, football player.
We got this little sign here. It was on a plane coming back from Clarion. And Coach Glenn Sevenall went to Clarion's locker room and snatched the sign off the wall. It says, "Believe." This is what our whole season was about.
No matter the obstacle, no matter the adversity, no matter the situation, the 1996 University of Northern Colorado Bears will always be remembered as a champion, a team that somehow was always able to find a way. The Bears Find a Way, the story of Northern Colorado's improbable run to the 1996 Division II football championship, is a production of 1310 KFKA and King Chamberlain Oldsmobile, Cadillac, Jeep, Eagle, and Subaru.